I invite you to stand if you are able to do so. If not, if that's uncomfortable, just may your spirit rise with us, calling ourselves more fully into worship. Holy source of life, in the beginning, you made us and called us beloved. When we forget how to love, you remind us we are beloved. When the powers of the world try to oppress us, you name us beloved. When our siblings in faith condemn us, you claim us beloved. We are your beloved. So today we sing your praises, holy source of love.
Please continue standing if you're able and join in singing our opening song, This is Amazing Grace. The lyrics will be on the screens.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. For me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Then you would take my place. Then you would bear my cross.
And any children or anybody who's feeling young at heart who would like to join me up here for a time with the children, I invite you to come forward.
As the children come forward, we invite you to join in singing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
How is everybody doing today? Good. Good? Good? All right, great. Now, I know you guys are all out of school right now. Is that true? Yeah. But when you're in school, did you ever have a time in gym class or at recess where somebody says, hey, we're going to pick teams now? Did you ever have that moment? Now, when they're picking teams, did you ever not be the first one picked or a second one picked or a third one picked? And maybe sometimes you were the last one picked. Anybody have that feeling? Maybe? It doesn't feel too good to be the last one picked. You never got to be the tagger ever? That doesn't feel very good, does it?
Just sometimes.
Well, when I was in school a while ago, I had a friend. This was in first grade. My friend's name was Matt. And Matt stuttered when he talked. And he couldn't get words out. And so some of the kids thought he talked kind of funny. And unfortunately, some of them picked on him because he talked different. And they made fun of him, and they bullied him. And I remember when I was about your age thinking, that's not right. I don't think Jesus would be very happy about that. Do you? No. Just because somebody struggles with how they talk, or they look a different way, or they dress a different way, or they see things in a different way in life does not mean they should be picked on. And so part of today, as we talk about, there's going to be a lady, a couple of women that we talk about today in church who really struggle with fitting in. One of them in particular felt very alone and really just needed somebody who would say, I see you. And I know some of the things you're going through. And I'm not going to let you walk through that alone. I'm going to walk with you so you don't feel left out, you don't feel last, you don't feel picked on, and you know you're treasured and beloved. So boys and girls, before we pray, I want you to think about in the days ahead when you're on the playground or when you're with your friends or you're back at school and you see somebody who somebody else is picking on the bus or in the classroom. And in that moment, I want you to be brave. I want you to remind that person they are loved and stick up for them. Do you think you could do that?
Yeah.
Walk together with somebody who's feeling alone? I hope we all can do that. Let us pray. Jesus, there were a lot of people that were really confused and even upset with you because you choose to spend most of your time with people who had been picked on. Left out, treated as less than, made fun of, even laughed at because people didn't think they were spiritually good enough. You had a different thing in mind with what makes a person treasured, simply because they're named by God and made in God's image, one of a kind. So help us to defend our brothers and sisters who are hurting, to walk together, and to shine your love in bravery whenever we are able. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls.
As our youth heads off to Sunday school, we invite you to join once again in singing Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me still today, walking with me on my way, wanting as a friend to give light and love to all who live. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is from Mark 5, 21 through 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet. He pleaded with him repeatedly, "My daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that may be made well and live." So he went with him. A large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a lady who had been suffering from a flow of blood for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had. And she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his cloak, I will be made well." Immediately her flow of blood stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that the power had gone from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my cloak?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the synagogue leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the synagogue leader, "Do not be afraid, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the synagogue leader's house, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl stood up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. May God speak to us through these scriptures today. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Welcome me. how can this be? My guilt is undone, my past is untethered.
I invite you to please join with me in a word of prayer. Amazing God, for a grace that isn't tethered by human limitations or understanding or determinations, for a welcome that isn't attached to hidden agendas for being called by name by the great I Am, proclaimed that since before we could speak a word, you have known us fully and completely, made in your image, male or female, gay or straight, black or white, and all the colors in between. Amazing God, thank you. You who are creator, sustainer, and redeemer of all, who delight in restoration and fullness, who call us to openness and vulnerability and relationship, deep relationship with you that is unbridled and permeates every aspect of who we are and who we hope to be. Meet us in this moment, this Sunday, and every day thereafter, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Robin and I and the kids were here but a minute in 2012. I remember we moved in. It was January, a snowstorm. And we had been at the church for about 3 months. Many of you remember that time. Some of you are newer than that. When our oldest daughter, Jillian, got sick. First, I thought it was a flu. Temperature was rising 100, 101, 102. We took her into the ER. They gave her IVs and fluids, dehydration, and told us to go home, and we did. And they had brought the fever down. And then a day and a half later, back up again, back to the hospital. And days started to turn into weeks. Specialists came in to take blood, take samples to test for these and that. Jillian was 35 pounds when she went into the hospital. She didn't have weight to lose. And those weeks started to turn into hospital to hospital to hospital. A lot of time on my knees. God, just tell us who we got to go to. Help us find the answers because she's not getting better. And there was a moment, I remember as Robin and I were watching her on the playground. You never know it today. But we watched these other kids playing. We took the girls out to a little splash pad, and all the other kids were playing, and she was just skeletal. Back to the hospital. And I remember that very pointed moment when I thought, God, am I losing her? It's a horrible feeling as a parent or as a spouse, as a best friend, as a son or daughter, to sit on a bedside with somebody you love and to watch them physically fade away. And it doesn't matter what your reputation is, doesn't matter how much you went to school, doesn't matter if you have resources or you don't have any, because everything is stripped away in those moments of life, and you just feel helpless because you can't fix it. Maybe some of you have been there. I'm sure many of you have been there. Jairus, synagogue ruler, leader in the community, well-respected, a man of resources and power, social and financial, is there. His 12-year-old daughter is dying. He grows through this crowd of people who have come to hear Jesus speak, come to see him, the one that so many have been talking about, and he falls on his knees and begs, pleads repeatedly, please, Jesus, come with me. Time is of the essence. My little girl is at home, and we don't think she's going to make it. I need you to come and to help us. Will you come? Everything that he values, all this other stuff that he is, doesn't matter one bit compared to his little girl and doing whatever he can to make sure she's okay. Interestingly, as Luke and Matthew tell the story, Matthew has Jairus
Jairus come to Jesus after his daughter has already died. So he's asking for a miracle beyond what he knows. But in Mark's telling of the story, there's an urgency. The clock starts ticking as soon as Jairus talks to Jesus. And you get this sense that we've got to go now. I imagine, doesn't say it in the text, but I imagine him pushing people in the crowd, having his friends help him move this mob of people, taking Jesus maybe by the cloak or by the hand and saying, come on. There's no turning back. Each step may be growing more hopeful. But Mark does something unusual. And Mark's not usually very verbose. If you read the first chapter of Mark, it takes Mark maybe 20 verses to say what it takes Matthew and Luke 4 chapters to say. So when Mark goes into some details, our antenna should go up. And there's a seminary term for it, but I'm just going to call it sandwiching two stories together. Jairus and his daughter are the bread, the beginning and end of the story. And they're front and center as soon as we get into what Jesus is saying and these characters. But then Mark introduces a third figure to the story, an interloper, an interrupter, an interjector. And as Jairus is tugging Jesus, he stops and turns back, and Jairus is saying, what's going on? Hey, we got to go. And Jesus is talking some strange thing about who touched me to a crowd of people that we just pushed through. And the disciples are confused, and Jairus is confused. And there's this other woman. And we have some commonalities of detail. 12 years. For as long as Jairus has had his daughter in this earthly life, this other woman has suffered. Day by day, week by week, year by year. It says she's tried everything, gone to doctor after doctor after doctor, spent everything she's got, endured much, much of it physical, but in between the lines, there's a lot more going on there. We'll get to that in a minute. And she, in desperation, just like this well-known synagogue leader, comes to Jesus on a wing and a prayer, falls at his knees. But not yet. When she first starts, unlike Jairus' public asking of Jesus, she sneaks through the crowd. Something, by the way, by law she's not allowed to do, because we're told by Mark's gospel that she has a bleeding disorder, uterine. And so she has a blood flow. And this blood flow, she can't stop. Sometimes maybe momentarily, but then it starts up again. And this may be hard for us as modern readers of the gospel to fully wrap our heads around. So let's take a minute to get a sense of what this was really like. Because I think for modern readers, especially perhaps women, it's difficult to think of a woman who's having her monthly, or who has had a baby, or who has suffered the trauma of a miscarriage, as also somehow carrying the label of spiritually unclean? Who made these rules? Well, a bunch of guys. But why? But why? And this isn't something that neatly translates. These are thousands of years old holiness code. Talking about blood as a life-giving thing and a wound or a bleeding as something that is escaping that life-giving blood. And so, whether it's for health or it's for fear, these laws about bleeds and bodily emissions, whether that's male or female, they're all listed there in Levitical and numerical and numbers code. But for 7 days, a woman's having her period, she's seen as unclean. If you've ever read the book, the novel, The Red Tent, you get a good sense of this. It's a great book about the power of women back in biblical times, but talks about that, having to separate, having to go to a different tent, having to, anything you touch is unclean. Anyone who touches you is unclean. So every time that she goes through this, she has to check her body, and she has to go to the faith leader of the town because she's been ill. And then if it's okay for a time, then she goes, starts again, back. So this is emotional yo-yoing back and forth. Am I better? No, you're not. Am I better this time? No, you're not. And I said there's more to than a physical hemorrhaging here, because there's also that social stigma as people start to say, what's wrong with her in social circles? Shaming or feeling ashamed of her body. Somehow she's not normal. Somehow I'm broken. I'm not like everybody else. And that desperation, enduring not just the physical, but the emotional and spiritual weight of never feeling whole, never feeling quite right. In this case, an illness, a hemorrhaging. Because when you're sick, whether you've got Crohn's disease, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, celiac, depression, cancer, there's those moments when you're trying to figure out what it is, and there's that worry and fear and trying to figure out what kind of diagnosis. We don't have any idea how to handle this because we don't know what it is. And then there's that moment when you do have a diagnosis. You say, all right, at least I know what it is, but you're feeling crummy. And as you're not feeling right, and you're feeling off, or your body feels listless or just not what it often feels, then you watch as everybody else in the world is busily going about forward. And here you are. You've got your public persona on the surface. How you doing? I'm good. But underneath it, no, I'm not. I'm not okay, not by a long shot. Because I'm carrying the weight of everything I'm holding in. And I'm watching the world continue to go by whatever is talked about as normal and as okay. And I'm trying to survive and I don't feel how I fit into this equation. And I'm hurting and I'm struggling. And while both of these stories in this text, these two daughters of Israel who are both linked together, the one is young and one is old, one has a social advocate in her dad who is a person of power, one doesn't. One tries to sneak in the back door, one goes public. Two very different social circumstances and settings, but Mark is bringing them together for a pointed lesson for us all. In that physical illness, there's also this social ostracization. And again, I focus in on that phrase, she has endured much pain, has carried much pain. Social stigmas and fears, apprehension, awkwardness when others encounter her. I remember two stories. The first, when we were in South Africa on a church mission trip. We were working with a children's home. We were building a stairwell and a floor for them. And we had a team of teachers, nurses, and then construction folks with us. And the children, these little guys, were out playing in the playground. This little girl fell off of a swing, and she skinned her knee and started to bleed. And the kids ran from her in terror. So did the teachers. And we couldn't figure out what was going on. Here was a little girl, probably 3 years old, fell off a swing, fell off a slide, and she was hurt. She was bleeding. Why wasn't anybody helping her? AIDS. Don't get near her. You might catch it. Fear. Stay away. Terror. And this nurse with us, gloved up, bandaged the girl, still standing away. Something different, something unknown. But I also think, my brothers and sisters, beyond physical illness with this text, of those who carry pain, who endure, especially on this Pride Sunday. When I was in Portage, Michigan, a play came out called The Seven Passages. It was written by Stephanie Sandberg, who for 4 years in the state of Michigan collected stories from 130 gay, lesbian, and trans Christians, men, women, teens, who had grown up in the church and their experiences in the church, particularly, she called it seven passages, for the seven passages in Scripture that often lifted and used against or attacking LGBTQ folk. The play in its entirety comes from people who have been interviewed and their words. It's a powerful play. The very first story comes out like this. He says, "I never dared to tell anyone what I knew in my heart. It was taboo and forbidden. And so I prayed that God would change me so that I could be like everyone else, like they were teaching me. I saw my orientation as some kind of illness that I carried and that God had to heal me of. And my church at the time reinforced that belief and did me no favors in thinking that I somehow could not be loved by a God who called me by name." In that same vein, I remember a friend of mine who went to seminary with me, who was in the Jesuit order, studying to be a Catholic priest. A friend of his from his neighborhood, also a priest, who had gone and started seminary with him, but was 3 years ahead of him and from his neighborhood. My friend knew he was probably oriented the other way, but they never talked about it until later in their seminary experience. He confided in my friend in a very vulnerable moment. He, being ahead of my friend, got his ordination and served a parish. And my friend recalls that in his struggles and in his prayer life, his knees were physically calloused from his prayer life. He went to his bishop to talk to him in vulnerability and in confidence about his orientation, that he was gay. He had not even told his parents. He trusted this bishop. And not an hour after he left the meeting, hoping that his bishop would give him guidance, his bishop made a call to the judiciary, calling for him to be defrocked as a pastor, as a priest. Going public with the findings team, and him finding out on a Sunday mass that he was no longer welcome to be the priest of the church, his family gathered there, finding out in a humiliating, devastating fashion something that he had tried to protect as a sacred secret. The man wrote in his diary about the shame that the way that happened brought upon him, how small it made him feel, despair, depression, and like, unfortunately, the story of so many young LGBTQ people, he ended up taking his life because he could not believe, because the church behind him told him, "No, you can't be one of us." There are too many on the road of faith of these stories of people's woundedness and pain, enduring much, seeking out Christ in beauty and in wonder and in vulnerability. Too many. So today's text matters not only for those who have been there physically, but also spiritually or socially, who've been left out of the equation, socially or spiritually shunned, felt frayed in their hope and their acceptance, and wondered year over year because they've been told, "What's wrong with me?" Their private hurts. And a church that has sometimes treated them universally as anathema instead of the beautiful and yet hurting children of God. Made wonderfully in God's image. Mark tells these two stories of two women, two very different women, at a time when women don't count. All you have to do is read a few verses later, the feeding of the 5,000. You know the story. And 5,000 were fed, men. There were more there than men, but 5,000 men were fed, and some women and children. And Mark takes these two stories of two women linked by 12 years, linked by desperation and hope in Christ, and says, see these two women. Neither of them are named. The man is, but they're not. Mark says, pay attention. These women count, even if society's not counting them. These women matter, and they matter a lot in 2024 when a church body tells its church that has a female pastor just a month ago, several weeks ago, that they can't be part of the denomination because their minister is a woman. Women count. They matter before the eyes of God. They're not property. And they can receive this power just like any man, either by touching the Son of God or being touched by Him. And so I am grateful for the places in the body of Christ who proclaim the same for LGBTQ folk and friends. When the church lives into the kind of grace, honesty, and dignity of all God's children. Back to that text. This woman who hears about Jesus, just like Jairus had heard about him, says, if I can just touch his garment, just sneak in, nobody has to know. And by the by, because she's unclean, if she touches anybody in the crowd, she's making them unclean. She's risking. She's being vulnerable. And my brother, if you read, watch Church Without Borders, our Bible study, he says, you know, he thinks, his take on it, we don't always agree, his take on it was that she had a sense of who Jesus really is and his power, and if she just does this small thing, it'll be enough, such as her faith. That's why he says, your faith has saved you, which is entirely possible, and it's a beautiful notion. I love that interpretation. But I go on the other side of it and say, I think she thought more like he was a faith healer. And that, like so many places, even if you go to Europe today, you know, in the cathedral, we have a fingernail of the Apostle Paul, or we have, you know, a piece of the cross from Jesus. We have the breast milk of Mary. My brother brought this up, and I said, what? There's a church that has the breast milk of Mary? Yes, actually there is, allegedly. And if you get by these things, they have healing properties. That's why I kind of think where the wavelength with this woman was. And as she touches him, she knows. I want to put herself in this woman's shoes. After 12 years of carrying this, something has shifted. She knows. I'm okay. In a way, I haven't been okay. And instead of letting it go at that, Jesus calls her out. I think he knows who touches him. Kind of like that Garden of Eden scene where God's, you know, walking about the garden, doesn't know where Adam and Eve are, they're playing hide and seek. Come on, God doesn't know where they are, come on. Anyway, I think it's because there's more than a physical healing Jesus wants to talk about, as does the gospel writer of Mark. Who touched me? And it says she comes and falls at his feet, worships, lays it all out. Vulnerability. This is who I am. Things I haven't told maybe anybody else. This is where I've been. This is my story. And she trusts Jesus with it, and he says, your faith, your trust in me has made you whole. Not just the hemorrhaging. Whole, beloved, treasured, one of a kind. Meanwhile, Jairus, let's not forget about him, is waiting. We don't know how much time this is taking, but time is of the essence. Remember, we got a little girl back there who's dying. And here comes the messengers, heads down. She didn't make it. It's too late. Imagine a hand on the shoulder. Let's go home. Don't bother the teacher anymore. And Jesus pushes through it. Nope, let's go. Comes to the house, and here's the thing that I also key in on. Disciples, when the woman touches Jesus, are incredulous. What are you talking about? Who touched you? What are you doing? Gets to the house. There's the mourners, the professional mourners, wailing and mourning. They say, she's dead. Jesus says, nah, she's just fallen asleep. You just let me do my thing. And they laugh at him and reject him and scorn him. And I think, wow, you've got these two situations where people on the periphery aren't open enough to let God do God's thing. They're going to put roadblocks or barriers and say, yeah, not you. Limitations on who can and who cannot be healed, who can come, who can't, when it's over or when it's not. And Jesus says, not so fast. That's not yours to decide. He goes up to the room and says to her, Talitha cum, it's an Arabic phrase. In English, it says, little girl, get up. Another translation of that is, be resurrected. From death to life. From being lost to being found. From being cast out to being welcomed, affirmed, and treasured, and called by name. That is good news. It's not all right news. It's not okay news. It is good news for every man, woman, or child who walks through these doors and beyond them. Amen. I'm going to invite us into a moment of silent prayer, and then I'm going to do something a little different in our prayer time. I came across a letter to the editor from a pastor named John Pavlovich several years ago, and I'd like to share that as prayer today. But before we do that, a couple of prayer requests and concerns for the Tullis family at Brenda's death and their grieving, her memorial this Friday. For the Walsh family, Amy Walsh and Alex Comgard got married here in the church yesterday, and so we celebrate with joy for them. For many who continue to be in hospital, and for those things that we carry today here, let us pray. God, whatever we carry individually or collectively as a people, for the things that we think about here in Downers Grove or in our own families, and the things we think about and pray about for our world, our leaders, hear our prayer. Give us courage to be salt and light. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go. Sometimes I wonder if I'll have a gay child. I'm not sure if other parents think about this, but I do quite often. Maybe it's because I have many gay people in my family and circle of friends. It's in my genes, in my tribe. Maybe it's because as a pastor of students, I've seen and heard horror stories of gay kids, Christian kids, from both inside and outside the closet, trying to be part of the church. Maybe it's because as a Christian, I interact with so many people who find homosexuality to be the most repulsive thing imaginable and who make it abundantly clear every time and every conceivable opportunity. But for whatever reason, it's something I ponder frequently as a pastor and as a parent, and I wanted to make some promise to you, my two kids, right now. If I have a gay child, you'll know it. My children won't be our family's best-kept secret. I won't talk around them in conversations with others, or speaking code or vague language. Childhood's difficult enough, and most LGBT kids spend their entire existence being horribly, excruciatingly uncomfortable, and I'm not going to put mine through any more unnecessary discomfort just to make Thanksgiving dinner a little easier for a third cousin with misplaced anger issues. If my children come out, we'll be out as a family. If I have a gay child, I'll pray for them. I won't pray for them to be normal. I've lived long enough to know that if my children are gay, that is their normal. I won't pray that God will heal them or change them or fix them. I will pray for God to protect them from the ignorance and hatred and violence that the world will throw at them simply because of who they are. I'll pray that God shields them from those who despise them and wish them harm, who curse them to hell and put them through hell without ever knowing them at all. I'll pray that they enjoy life, that they laugh, that they dream and feel and forgive, and that they love God and all people. And above all, I'll pray to God that my children won't allow the ungodly treatment they might receive from some of his misguided children to keep them from pursuing him. If I have a gay child, I'll love them. I don't mean some token, distant love, tolerant love that stays safe at arm's length. It will be an extravagant, open-hearted, unapologetic, lavish, embarrassing them in the school cafeteria, kissing them in public kind of love. I won't love them despite their sexuality. I won't love them because of it. I'll love them for the same reasons I already do, because they're sweet and funny and caring and smart and kind and stubborn and flawed and original and beautiful and mine. If my kids are gay, they may doubt a million things about themselves in this world, but they'll never doubt for a second whether or not their daddy is over the moon crazy about them. God has already created them and wired them and placed the seed of who they are within them. Psalm 139 says he stitched them together in their mother's womb. Incredibly intricate stuff that makes them uniquely them, once in a history souls, has already been uploaded to their very cells. And so many of you may be offended by all this, I fully realize. I know this may be especially true if you're a religious person with a particular theological stance. Perhaps you find the whole topic unsettling. And as you've been reading, you may have been rolling your eyes, clicking the roof of your mouth, or drafting familiar scriptures to send to me. You may be praying for me to repent, or preparing to unfriend me, or writing me off as sinful, evil, hell-bound heretic. But with as much gentleness and understanding and kindness as I can muster, I really couldn't care less. This isn't about you. It's a whole lot bigger than you. You're not the one I waited for breathlessly for 9 months. You're not the one I wept with joy when you were born. You're not the one I bathed and fed and rocked to sleep through 100 intimate midnight snuggle sessions. You're not the one I taught to ride a bike, whose knees scraped, I kissed with tiny trembling hands who I held whilst getting stitches. You're not the one whose head I love to smell, whose face lights up when I come home at night, whose laughter is like music to my weary soul. You're not the one who gives my days meaning and purpose, and who I adore more than I thought I could ever adore anything. You're not the one I hopefully will be with when I take my last precious breaths on this planet, gratefully looking back on a lifetime of shared treasure and resting in the knowledge that I loved you well. So if you're a parent, I don't know how you respond if you find out your children are gay, but I pray you consider it. Because one day, despite your perceptions of your kids or how you parented, you may need to respond in real time to a frightened, frantic, hurting child, one whose sense of peace and identity and acceptance, whose heart and very life may be placed in your hands in a way you never imagined, and you will need to respond. If that day should ever come for me, if my children should ever come out to me, that is the dad I hope to be to them. Amen.
On that powerful note, as we move into this time of offering, the offering is that passing of the peace. And the passing of the peace is that reminder that of all the labels that we may wear, the only label that we have in the body of Christ is beloved. You are beloved. So beloved to beloved, pass that peace that surpasses all human understanding, one to another. Because when you are here, all you should ever feel is beloved, because that's who you are. Beloved of God in God's home. pass the peace to one another.
Please stand for the singing of our doxology.
Give thanks to the God who unites us in one family and has invited us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
We invite you to continue standing if you're able and join in singing our closing hymn, Alchemy of Healing, which is from the hymnal of Songs for the Holy Other. It is not in our hymnal, so you can find the lyrics on the screens.
My brothers and sisters, as we go out these doors of church, you continue to be church. Whether you're on a trail somewhere in Alaska and somebody's asking you questions of faith, or you're out at Grove Fest, or you're going to school or to work, may God's light help you to be the salt of the earth, to bring others closer to God instead of repulsing them, and to help them see how they are loved by God through your life. Go in the peace, grace, and hope of Christ our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us. We invite you to either stay in your seats or come on up and join us for our postlude, We Are Family.
I got all my sisters with me. We are family.
much. Have a wonderful Sunday. Happy Pride, and we will see you at Messy Church next week.